it sort of innovative and sort of strange installation in the 18th century. It's really rather unique and quite different from how you see it today in the museum, as well as its provenance. And so provenance, of course, meaning the journey, the tracing, the sort of location, the time and space of this particular painting. So today, I want to talk a little bit about those sort of original circumstances of its painting in the 18th century and how it came from France to New Orleans in the mid-19th century and eventually to our museum in the mid-20th century. So the painting was painted by Natoire in the 1730s, and Natoire was trained in Paris as a young artist. And in the 1720s, he won the Prix de Rome, which is this really sort of prestigious painting competition. Installed and embedded in the walls of the chateau in this So Psyche, the sort of central nymph figure that you see here, is a beautiful royal princess who attracts the jealousy of Venus, the Roman goddess of love and beauty, because she is so beautiful. So Venus becomes envious of her and essentially wants to destroy her. So she basically asks her son, Cupid, who famously has a sort of poison love arrows, he makes everyone fall in love with anybody. She asks her son Cupid to make Psyche fall in love with a monster, a serpent, to basically ruin Psyche's life and sort of take it out of picture. But Cupid struggles with this idea because he himself has fallen in love with Psyche. Now, meanwhile, Psyche's father has learned of this sort of terrible fate that is in store for his daughter after he consults with an oracle. And he's like, well, I better just sort of let this happen and get her out of the way so I don't cause any risk to myself. So he ties Psyche to a rock on the top of a hill and sort of lets her wait for her sort of evil serpent husband to come fetch her. And Cupid intervenes, blows Psyche away, soliciting the help of the god of wind, Zemurray, and blows Psyche to the top of another mountain where he has a fabulous palace. And so Psyche arrives in this beautiful, mysterious palace, unknowing of what fate is upon her, and she encounters all of these nymphs who prepare her for her first encounter with Cupid. And that's the scene that we see here, at this moment where Psyche has just arrived at Cupid's palace, not knowing who is responsible for this sort of change in her fate. She's being sort of pampered, perfumes and ointments and her hair is being arranged by all these nymphs that surround her. The rest of the Psyche nymph is actually rather complicated and strange. Psyche becomes quite curious about who has become, who her sort of mysterious lover is. He sort of has taken her away to this mysterious palace, and he visits her at night, but refuses to reveal his identity to her. It's Cupid, of course, but he doesn't want her to know that. So she becomes extremely curious and sort of insecure about who her mysterious lover is. So in the middle of the night, she lights a candle over the sleeping Cupid and discovers his identity. He wakes and becomes furious with her for sort of betraying his orders, and he leaves her. And so the rest of the narrative, which is embellished in Jean de La Fontaine's 17th century version of the story, is Psyche trying to win Cupid back. So again, Natoire represented four different episodes from that sort of really long period, that kind of broad narrative. So after he painted this 4 series for the Legion Guard, it remains at the chateau for another generation, after which his son sells the painting and most of the contents. And it goes through a series of other sort of French private collections during and after the French Revolution, and eventually ends up with a Spanish collector in Madrid. And that's around 1798. And there it stays for about 10 years until Napoleon arrives. So Napoleon, by this time, by 1808, has become emperor of the French and has taken Spain, has taken Madrid. And it's really sort of unclear how Napoleon came into possession of this particular painting, but somehow he does, and he gives it to his brother Joseph Bonaparte, who he installs as King of Spain. So Joseph remains King of Spain for only a brief amount of time, until the fall of Napoleon in 1815, after which he sort of flees Europe and comes to where else but New Jersey in 1815, and brings most of his collection of Pinochet back from New Jersey. But Joseph Bonaparte brings Natoire's painting and a bunch of his others from the art collection that he's gleaned through sort of connection with Napoleon to this new house in Bordentown, New Jersey. And there Natoire's painting stays for another 30 years. We actually have these wonderful anecdotes of these sort of early 19th century New Jersey women coming to visit the Bordentown house of Joseph Bonaparte, sort of remarking of how chilly these poor nymphs must have been in New Jersey winters. After Joseph Bonaparte dies in 1744, his nephew sells most of Bonaparte's collection. And it's at that sale in New Jersey ambitions for his own collecting. He builds a sort of massive Italianate mansion in the Irish Channel in New Orleans, and you know, with this sort of ambition of filling it with art, including the works that he buys from public for sale. But James Robb is also involved in this really sort of early initiative in the 1840s to build a museum in New Orleans. And not just any museum, this sort of committee that forms in the 1840s, including James Robb, has ambitions to establish a national gallery, an American national gallery, in New Orleans as early as the 1840s. And that is really actually quite remarkable because it's only going to be another 30 years until the Metropolitan Museum of Art is founded in New York, and another 100 years until the actual National Gallery of Art is established in Washington, D.C. So James Robb really has both ambitions, and he imagines that his purchase from Bonaparte's collection is going to be the kind of kernel of the sort of new National Gallery of Art, right, that he envisions establishing with the sort of new. For a variety of reasons, this never happens, obviously. The National Gallery of Art is not in New Orleans. In part because James Robb goes bankrupt. He's been spending a little bit too much of his money building and constructing and buying. So he goes bankrupt. And so his mansion and most of its contents are sold multiple times until the Natoire painting comes into the possession of the Newman family in New Orleans. And they loan the painting when a new museum is established in 1911. That's the Isaac Delgado Museum, which eventually becomes the New Orleans Museum of Art. So this Natoire painting has passed through several hands from the sort of tax farmer in 18th century Paris to Joseph Bonaparte, the brother of Napoleon, to New Jersey, to New Orleans, and finally to the walls of our museum. And it's sort of